Okay. Hello, everyone. I know this is like a last presentation for today, so I will keep it in time and not like go beyond 6:30. So my name is Niranjan, and I'm a PhD student working in Stony Brook University. My research area is in security, and this is a co-work with other authors, where Zahir is actually the main author, and he could not be here, so I'm like presenting on his behalf. So the outline for the talk is I'm going to first talk about what is lightweight bound checking. So I will mention the concept and explain in detail what we are doing. So this work was presented as a research work in a conference called as Code Generation and Optimization. It's a CGO, and it was held in last year in San Jose. And the GCC plugin work that I'm presenting today is a like a implementation of that for GCC, so that research can be made to the end user. So the first part, I will go into the details. So memory error have been one of the significant problems in security for last several years. 2003 was one of the significant year because of the slammer bomb. It took down the internet. Considering the significance of memory errors, a lot of operating systems introduced ASLR as one of the defense. So ASLR is simply an address space randomization that is supported by the operating system. So user is completely user is completely transparent to the user. User doesn't see anything, and it's completely compatible with all the programs, and it has almost zero overhead. And that's why it is widely used and accepted. But as it happens with security, in 2010, ASLR was bypassed. And nowadays, there are a lot of attacks which actually exploit the weaknesses of ASLR and build sophisticated attacks to bypass ASLR. So what is the state? In 2013, if you search for memory errors, exploitable memory errors in NVD, we see that there are around 530 reportable memory errors which are exploitable. So it still signifies the importance of the problem. But then there's another question as, what is the problem with ASLR? So the problem with ASLR is that it's a probabilistic defense. So it relies on a randomization. And that is the true nature why it's a problem for it. So, I mean, a lot of these attacks which bypass ASLR exploit the probabilistic nature of ASLR itself. And so if we want to have a defense which is better than ASLR, we should have a deterministic and prompt defense, which stops the attack at the point where it is just about to happen. So the natural question is, what has been the previous work in this area? Because this is a well-researched area in security for several years. So I can classify the previous efforts into two categories. First is the research efforts, which actually have seen some research publications. So research efforts can again be classified into three categories. Most of you must be familiar with Purify, Valgrind, these are well-known debugging techniques. There has been TypeSafe C dialects, which actually try to bring the type safety nature to the C language, because that has been the one of the inherent problems with C. And the third category is called as bounce checking, which actually enforces the property that a pointer in a C program should not try to dereference a memory which is out of bounds of an object that is supposed to point to. So there has been a lot of work in this area too, where some of them, like significant ones I have mentioned here. Where baggy bounce is the most recent one, and which is the fastest bounce checker right now. So on the second point, I mean the second classification of the previous efforts are, I'm going to put it into terms of what has been gone into GCC as a part of defenses. So the bounce checking techniques that went into GCC are, at least I am aware of, are two basically. One is mudflap and another is address sanitizer. I mean, today morning there was a presentation about address sanitizer, and it has been one of the most actively supported and developed project. So it's quite nice to see that all of that research and security defenses are going into compiler so that end user can benefit from the defenses. So just to mention briefly about what these techniques are doing. So mudflap basically checks that the pointer that you're trying to dereference is within the valid object. So it just verifies that the pointer is pointed to the valid object, and it instruments all risky pointer dereferences and arrays. Whereas address sanitizer has the same goal. It tries to perform out-of-bound access check for heap, stack, and global objects. And in addition, they also perform direct use after free bucks. So for that, they have developed a specialized memory allocator. So now you might be wondering, what new I am presenting? Already there is so much of research, and I'm talking about them already. So why do we need a new method? Is that most of the solutions are good, but they are not good as for the deployment, as in terms of real-time deployment on a server, where efficiency is the most critical requirement. So the problem with the existing solutions are two. First is the performance. The fastest previous bounce checker has 60% overhead, which is way higher than what a runtime defense requirements are. And in terms of compatibility, a lot of these techniques have very strict requirements, and that's why they break programs. One of the cases where they break programs is when pointer arithmetic comes into picture for C language. A lot of C programs have a tendency to generate invalid pointers using pointer arithmetic, but then do not try to dereference that invalid pointers. So that is considered a valid C program as per the standard, but these techniques cannot handle them because of their design or their limitations. So the key point to be learned here is that we should avoid checks on the pointer arithmetic in order to achieve compatibility, and then instead check pointer dereferences for achieving security. So I will now talk about how we go on achieving both of these things, which are actually critical for the runtime defense. But before that, I want to first highlight some of the limitations of the existing GCC-based implementations. So mudflap has been one of the significant one in the earlier days. But one of the key limitations of mudflap is that it only checks whether the address is pointing to a valid memory area. It does not check whether the pointer is pointing to an object that it is supposed to point to. So this is a simple C program which actually demonstrates the limitation of mudflap. So assuming that A and B are allocated on stack contiguously by the compiler, this simple for loop basically scans the memory area from A to B. So this is actually a memory error, because pointer is crossing the bounds of an object B and going to object A. But mudflap cannot handle this problem. So this is considered one of the limitation, because bounds checking solutions are supposed to handle this. And also another limitation of mudflap is that it has a very high performance overhead, which is 2x to 40x. An address sanitizer is actually a very impressive work, and supported. It's already there in GCC, and we can use it. But to me, it seems more like a debugging work, because they still have a 73% runtime overhead on spec programs, which is still very high if you want to employ that as a runtime defense on a server or a real production software. And also, the memory usage is quite high. 3x memory usage can be a problematic for a real server, because for a server, memory consumption must be in limits. So now I will talk about what we are doing to achieve efficiency and compatibility. So
3 times is too much for this, I would say, because generally it just uses the normal memory plus the schedule memory, which is 8 times smaller than, so it should be at most twice.
The red zones, extra usage.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, because everything becomes aligned as well. There's the red zones and.
And I mean, if I'm correct, for the detection of use after free bugs, the memory is not released promptly, right?
Yeah,
For the runtime.
Yeah, for the runtime part, sure. Right. So our approach is quite similar to what the address sanitizer is. This has been an approach that Purify has also taken in the past. So what we do is whenever there is an object in the memory, we modify its layout by adding front and rear guard zones. So here, object one and object two memory layout has been modified to insert guard zones in the front and rear. And whenever there is a pointer dereference like star P, we modify it with the check before the pointer dereference to verify that pointer is within the, not pointing to the guard zone, and within the bounds of the object. So one of the limitations of our technique naturally comes from how we design it, is that we cannot detect the errors where pointer jumps across the guard zone into another consecutive object. So jumping across the guard zone is one of the limitation. But given the fact that most of the exploits nowadays use the sequential nature of an overflow, this can be considered as a lesser of a significant limitation. But it is still a limitation. So given the how we design it, now the challenge is how to make it efficient so that it can actually be used in real software. So before going there, I first summarize the contributions. So this is simply a source-to-source transformation technique. And as I said before, we have two factors where we contribute. Our runtime overhead is only 23%, and space overhead is also 8%. And on the compatibility side, we have compiled around 7 million lines of code with our plugin and verified that it works. So the key point for our technique might be, to learn about is that we avoid instrumenting or verifying pointer arithmetic, but check pointer dereferences, which is actually the point to be learned from the defenses such as ASLR. So let's go into detail about how we achieve the efficiency and compatibility. So the simple approach to implement what we are trying to achieve is to just maintain a bitmap for the whole virtual memory of a program, where bit one represents the fact that that particular memory is a guard zone. So we can have one bit per byte of a virtual address space. So the size of the guard map for 32-bit is half a gigabyte. And in that case, the check simply looks like looking up into the guard map, whether that particular address that we are trying to dereference, the bit corresponding to it, if it is one, then it is a guard zone access. So we should actually terminate a program in that case or do whatever is the required action. If it is not one, then it's a valid access, then we let the dereference happen. So this is very simple approach, and it has been used in the past too. But the problem it has is that it's incompatible. The reason I say it's incompatible is because on a 32-bit machine, it takes a half a gigabyte of space, of a virtual address space. And finding that much of contiguous space might be a problem for some programs, where that program is already using a lot of virtual memory. So how do we improve on this compatibility issue? So we just split the guard map into two-level guard map. So this is simply can be considered as an array of pointers in C. So what we have here is that the first level array is only contiguous. Rest of the arrays are spread across the virtual memory. So there is no any contiguity requirement here. So to implement this approach, we just split pointer P into some X and Y. So where X and Y can be configured or determined based on our design choices. And then our check simply looks like looking up a two-level guard map and to check whether the bit corresponding to that is one. So this helps us solve compatibility issue, but it has a lot of performance overhead because for every pointer dereference, we are trying to now look it up into a two-level array, which is going to lead to a lot of data access, and it is going to lead to a lot of cache access where we have cache misses and cache hits happening. So to solve this problem, we now introduce a new check where we realized from the fact that we actually haven't used the value of the guard zone itself. So the red area marked here can be given a special byte pattern, which represents the fact that it is a guard zone, and we can use that byte value itself. So this is one of the improvement that can be done in address sanitizer, because address sanitizer also has these areas, but it does not use the value assigned to these areas. So what we are doing here is, we simply introduce an additional check that now we check that pointer dereference, the dereference value, if it is same as the guard zone value, then we now introduce an additional check. This needs to be done because the value in the guard zone might actually coincide with the data value. So in order to eliminate the case of false positives, we have to introduce the second check. So the first check here, if star p is equal to guard zone value, we call that as a fast check. That's fast check because see that the most common case is the case where program is performing valid accesses. So the case of invalid access is generally rare in programs. And in the most common case, we are dereferencing a value that program is going to dereference anyway. So on the fast path of a program, we haven't introduced an additional memory access. Whereas if the fast check holds true, then we actually perform a second level slow check. But because of the fact that most of the on the fast path we haven't introduced any additional memory accesses, this gives us a lot of performance benefit. And I have some results later which shows that this check actually helps us achieve a lot of improvement. Sorry?
Is it guaranteed to work? Like, if P points to somewhere like between straddling the boundary of a guard zone and an object, so it will not see the guard zone value?
Yeah, okay, right. So we now have some like introduced the alignment requirements. So the alignment, so all objects are aligned on 8-byte boundary. So
right,
those are.
If the program has a bug, then you don't need to have an align pointer.
Right, yeah, I understand your point, but in that case, we also introduce a check based on the type of the pointer that you're trying to dereference. So let's say you are trying to dereference an integer pointer, which is 3 bytes before the object and into the guard zone, then we will check only those 3 bytes based on the type of the pointer. Okay, so the next design choice will be what should be the size of the guard zone. Because size of the guard zone is a critical, and it's a trade-off between security and the performance. So higher size of the guard zone actually gives a better security but hampers the performance. So we have a configurable formula which actually chooses from the max of k into element size and request size by n, where element size is the size that if can be computed at compile time will be used. So in case of arrays, the element size is the size of an element, whereas the request size for array will be size of the total array itself. Whereas for heap allocations, we cannot compute the element size ahead of time. So we, in that case, use element size which is same as request size. And in our formula, k and n are configurable by the tool user. So actually, tool users can specify what should be the value of k and n itself. And then to achieve additional advantages in terms of performance, we implement a lot of optimizations. So one of the simple optimization is the compiler optimization, which the fact here is that a variable whose address is not involved, a variable whose address cannot be taken is not involved in an overflow anyway. So we can eliminate such variables, calling them safe variables, because those cannot be involved in an overflow. We also use some additional compiler optimizations because we operate as a GCC plugin. GCC always already gives us a lot of optimization for free. So this kind of a common sub-expression elimination optimization, we do not need to worry about them at our level, because those will be taken care of by the compiler itself. The second one is the guard zone placement. So on the left-hand side is a stack layout for a x86, where x and y are two local variables of a function, And let's say both of them, I have taken the address of both of them. So as per our technique, we are going to introduce guard zones for X and Y. But see that the rear guard zone of X and the front guard zone of Y, they are contiguous. So basically, we can actually optimize them and use only one for both of them. So we combine the rear of X and front of Y into a single guard zone, and that helps us save some of the memory operations. So this is an optimization which actually helps a lot of, which gives us a lot of benefit for stack improvements. The third optimization is the lock optimization. And this is the effective for multi-threaded programs, because in our case, guard map is the is a global data structure. And one of the simple approach will be to lock the guard map for all the concurrent accesses. But we do not use lock at all. And we have developed an approach where we reason about why we do not need locks for the guard map. And we still preserve the correctness of the approach. So I won't go into detail because that is there in the paper. I mean, if you are interested, then you can refer to it. But this also gives some of the improvements for the multi-threaded programs. And the fourth optimization, which was quite significant in terms of the numbers, was the static analysis. So this has been established that in most C programs, pointers are not involved in an arithmetic. Most of the pointers are used safely. So we can actually eliminate guard zones for such pointers, because pointers which are not involved in an arithmetic cannot be involved in an overflow. So basically, the approach falls down into classifying pointer into two categories. One is called as safe and another is called as unsafe. Safe pointers cannot cause an overflow. Unsafe pointers can cause an overflow. So we first define these two types. And what we are going to do is we are just going to introduce checks on the unsafe pointers and eliminate all checks to the safe pointers, because safe are, they cannot be involved in an overflow. But then we realized that there was already a research in 2005 by Professor Nekula. He worked on classifying pointers in C language into three categories. And their notion of safety, safe pointers, was same as our notion of safety. So we can directly reuse their algorithm to compute the safe pointers. And this is where we actually optimize most of the redundant checks on the safe pointers. But then we also made an important change into the secured algorithm. The change that we made, I'm going to demonstrate this with a simple C program. And the significance of the check is also important. So it's a simple C program where I have defined an integer array of two elements, and pointer Q is pointed to the base. I use a for loop, and I'm going to increment a pointer by, so pointer is incremented by 2. So at the end of the loop, Q is pointing to the byte next to the end of the array. So, and then Q is assigned to P. So realize that Q is involved in an arithmetic, whereas P is safe, because P is not involved in an arithmetic. But there is an assignment between unsafe pointer and safe pointer, because Q is unsafe. So what secure does is to preserve the correctness of the approach, they introduce a check here. The check verifies that Q is within the bounds of the object that it is supposed to point to, because they want to classify P as safe pointer. And that check here fails because Q is actually pointing to an array out of an array. But realize that this is the correct C program. There is no memory error in this C program. So this failure should not happen. So, and this is a compatibility issue for our purpose. So here we trade off some performance for compatibility, and we call P as an unsafe pointer here. So in our case, there cannot be an assignment between unsafe pointer and safe pointer. If this happens, then we also classify safe pointer as an unsafe pointer. The significance of this decision is that we are going to classify more pointers as unsafe, and we will have more checks. We will lose some performance, but compatibility is preserved, and the soundness and correctness is preserved. So This is the earlier implementation of my research. So we developed this as a plugin to SIL framework. SIL is one of the framework from UC Berkeley, which actually allows you to modify C program representation. So it was developed in OCaml. It's one of the programming languages, and it had 5K lines of code. And we have a runtime support library, which actually is 1K lines of code. And we also modify the glibc's heap allocator, because we also want to modify the heap layouts and handle all the allocation and free functions. And our implementations now support 32-bit and 64-bit Linux. So it's available for download, and I'm more than happy if you tried and give me your feedback. But this is the earlier implementation. I'm going to describe about the GCC plugin after. So on the evaluation side, we have 4 different categories for the evaluation. So we first talk about the compatibility. Then, since it's a security defense, I'm going to evaluate how it performs in terms of security defenses. Then I have a measurement about the runtime and space overhead. And then I will talk about the effectiveness of different optimizations that we developed. So as I said before, for the compatibility, we compiled this. We compiled around 7 million lines of code with this compiler, and these are some of the programs that we actually compiled and verified that they work. In terms of evaluating the technique against security attacks, we used 2 benchmarks. These are all research benchmarks which are used for security evaluation. So the first benchmark is composed of real-world programs, and it's composed of vulnerabilities in them. So in the first benchmark, we were able to detect and prevent all the overflows. And second benchmark is called as RIPE, and it's an automated technique of generating an attacks. So it had 850 different attacks and different matrices, such as 4 attack areas, 5 code pointers. So in all there are 850 attacks, out of which we were able to prevent 770. We could not defend against the 80 attacks, because those involved intra-object overflows. So intra-object overflows are not handled by our technique. The reason is that, so intra-object overflows basically is a class where, let's say there are 2 arrays inside a structure, and one array overflows into the next array. To prevent against this kind of an attack, we need to insert a guard zone in between the 2 arrays inside a structure. And that can lead to a compatibility issue. So we trade off performance in that sense. So we, maintain the compatibility, we decided to eliminate this class of attacks. And so these are not detected by our technique. So in terms of runtime overhead, we did the evaluation for SPEC 2000, because the research comparison that we did was they had used SPEC 2000, so we had to use that too. So these are the numbers, and we have compared them with Baggy, which is the fastest previous bound shaker. So they had 60% overhead. So on the average, we do half better than them. So we have 23% overhead. And on the space overhead part of it, we have only 8% overhead. And most of it comes from the fact that we use 0.5 GB of guard map size. So on a 64-bit address space, we might have a lesser percentage. So this is going to talk about the effectiveness of different optimizations that I described before. So the blue line represents the numbers without any optimization, the basic 3-step design that I demonstrated before. So this is also the technique used by Purify. And if you recall, then Purify also had a similar performance overhead. They had quite a high numbers. The green line represents the performance overhead with the fast check. So I mean, the fact that not introducing any additional memory accesses on the fast path of a program. So see that with the fast check, we prevent a lot of, we reduce a lot of overhead, and the if I remember the number with the fast check, the performance comes down from 550 to around 80%. So that's a quite a significant saving in performance overhead. With the lock optimization that we implemented, we saved it again, I think, around by 40%. And with the static analysis, we saved, I think, around 20%. So the final number comes to around 23%. So for some of the C programs, static analysis was not that effective. There are some limitations of static analysis technique that CQUID has developed, and we are trying to improve on that. So hopefully we will be able to save much more with the static analysis. So this is the related work in terms of research that has gone into the bounce checking and security defenses. I won't go into details. If you're interested, you can refer to the paper. It's already there in the paper in detail. So in second part, now I'm going to talk about the GCC plugin for LVC, and to see to describe in detail what I'm doing for GCC. So the goal of my research for GCC plugin was to make my research reach the wider audience, so that end user can get a benefit of my research and they can actually deploy the defense as a runtime defense using my compiler. And there is nothing more pleasurable for a researcher to see that his research is getting used in practice. I think it's better than going to maybe Hawaii. So the current status of the project is that we have a full implementation which is working. So it modifies the GIMPL representation of a program. It handles C, C++ code, and it's around 2K lines of code. With the status, most of the implementation is done and it's ready. But before the evaluation numbers come out and we get the final numbers, we need to do some bug fixing, and that's where some of the effort needs to go. But given the fact that we are using the GCC optimizers before we operate on the GIMPL, this is purely based on my intuition. We should get better performance as compared to what I got with my earlier research. So it should be better than 23%. But it's purely intuition. I mean, it might be wrong. And there are some of the interesting challenges ahead with what I'm doing. And I'm going to briefly mention about the challenges and let the discussion open. If you have any feedback or any suggestions, I'm more than welcome. So one of the challenges is how to implement static analysis in GCC framework. The CQUID analysis and our analysis that we used requires whole program analysis. So the effectiveness of that analysis improves if we have whole program analysis. So my assumption is that we can use the GCC's LTO framework for this, but it's an open-ended question. I'm not sure if it will be really beneficial or if there is any other way that I can achieve this. The second challenge is in terms of heap management. Currently, we modify the glibc's heap allocator and use a new library. But I believe that if we want to deploy this tool and ship it to the end user, then modifying glibc doesn't seem to be a right approach. But I believe that that's more correct approach, because that way we are also able to handle some of the allocations that happen inside glibc. So we do not raise any false positives. But this is again an open question as to what can be a better approach. From the related work perspective, I guess Mudflap doesn't need to worry about this issue because they do not modify the object layout. And for the address sanitizer, they have their own heap allocator. So this is again an open question here for me. So I will just conclude here. So what I presented was a lightweight bounce checking technique, and it's a plugin for GCC, which is now ready and can be used. The runtime overhead of our technique is 23%, and the compatibility side, we have compiled around 7 million lines of code. So we believe that those two factors lead it into an easy deployment technique. And our implementation is available online. You are more than welcome to try it and give me your feedback. If you have any bugs or anything, you can send me an email. And now I'm open for the questions.
Thanks. Are you that you change potentially the size of the struct because you're adding guard zones inside it? Or
right.
Are there some other ABI changes to things like alignments?
So you're asking what can be a problem in that case? I didn't understand.
Yeah, I guess from the perspective of deployment, if you compile, you've got a library, you recompile that library with a plugin, isn't it going to break ABI compatibility?
Yeah, right.
Versus the old?
Yeah, that's why we avoid modifying the layout of the structure by modifying the fields inside the structure.
Right.
So that is surely an ABI non-compliant change.
So
that is the reason why we do not modify that. So the intra-object overflows are not detected by our technique.
Right.
Yeah.
So the focus is on security, but just wondering. You might have tried this with, say, a group of students who will make a lot of these kinds of pointer mistakes, and just how effective that was. I tried that.
Actually, students, I think, is like a second category. I mean, even on the spec programs, I saw a lot of like a C pointer mistakes. So spec is well recognized benchmarks, and if there are some mistakes, then I think students are free. I mean, they are like excused. Yeah.
What is your impression of the acceptable overhead for this to be used in production?
So there is a research paper which actually has did some significant and comprehensive analysis of different defenses and what should be the overhead and what are different requirements for a runtime defense. And their take is that it should be less than 5%. So, but it's quite a challenge that you have to defend against most of the attacks and still your performance is less than 5%. So that's an open-ended question basically in research for security. Not really. Again, like our static analysis, if it finds that a heap pointer is not involved in an arithmetic, then it is safe.
Why?
Because.
If I allocate 3 bytes and write an integer.
Right, but okay. So for heap allocator, we have an assumption that we basically pad that memory by adding extra bytes. But yeah, you are right. For heap, it can be a problem. But
and therefore, any C++ program which will use heap rather than like C and C++ programs have different profile.
I don't understand why C++ is.
C++ is usually much more heap heavy than C.
STD stream. Yeah, right.
Always allocates memory.
Yeah, but in our case, we enforce the alignment requirement for heap allocators. So, and there is some additional memory that is padded to the heap, the requested heap size. So, I'm not sure like if there can be a case where pointer is not involved in an arithmetic, it's a safe pointer, and it's used in a dereference for heap and that leads into a violation. So I'm not sure if that is a correctness violation for our case. Maybe we can like talk. I'm not exactly sure why that's the case. Like, yeah.
Wouldn't have a special value for the parts object? Wouldn't it be specified in the presence of PCC memory to be memory?
Yeah, it can be true, but we operate purely like at the software level, so that can be considered like an additional protection, I guess.
No, I mean, you wouldn't need any check in your code not in the active code, only in the memory error handler. Check if the memory error comes from a protected zone, the ordinary code would just happily dereference everything to it. It's a memory error.
Sorry, I didn't understand what you're trying to say.
If all the protected zones marked in ECC memory is the memory that fails to satisfy the validity check, then you would get an exception.
So you mean those guard zone byte patterns can be considered as an ECC memory? And then we'll have an exception or violation from the hardware when you're trying to dereference that area?
Yes.
Yeah, that can. Yeah, that is true. I believe Intel already has some instructions which actually perform bounce checking, but I'm not sure, I mean, how they are implemented in the internals.
I think more generally, if you have you know, some memory zone that is not readable,
mm-hmm.
Typically, granularity is not that small. Right? Typically, an operating system can only control the accessibility of up to a page size.
Yeah.
So if you have lots of objects, you're wasting lots of memory because you need a page to implement gaps in a hardware.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we really echo.
Yeah, right. So implementing this at the hardware level might be too much of an ask for a hardware, I guess.
Yeah, but, well, I mean, it's just, you know, it just occurred to me.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, that's true, but still.
Yeah,
so the size of the page.
Yeah,
right.
So regarding the memory consumption of your approach, compared to ASUN, I don't see a difference there. Because you add also the red zones.
Right.
So that's basically the same size as
yeah, but
ASUN. And you have also the tables.
Your table is compressed.
No,
but I'm...
But the tables at least have one byte per...
Yeah, so I...
One bit per byte.
One byte.
Yeah.
So that's again... 1/8
of an address space.
Of the address space you use, actually.
Yeah.
And because ASUN has huge virtual address space uses, that's sure. But it actually pages in only the pages you actually touch, so that should be comparable,
yeah.
And the rest of the overheads.
Yeah, I mean, I've
right,
noticed that your examples talk about the 32-bit case.
Right.
And ASAN largely said, well, just do it
64-bit,
so
yeah.
Don't worry. So you have plenty of address space and the virtual address space use is not a problem.
Right. But
well, so the major change compared to ASAN IC is the trick that you actually first read the...
Yeah, read the byte.
Yeah,
memory, normal memory.
Yeah,
yeah, right.
So first read and check for the magic value, but perhaps you could do the same with ASAN.
Yeah, I guess.
The only problem is those special descriptors inside at the start of the frame for automatic variables.
No, but then, I mean, you also need to consider that once going to use that kind of a check, you now have to pay the overhead of initializing those memory areas, right? So the guard zone values need to be initialized with special byte values, and that is going to lead to a lot of memory writes. And that is going to lead into a performance overhead. So I guess why we get such a low number is because of this the static analysis, that we classify a lot of pointers as safe pointers. And once we classify a lot of pointers and objects as safe pointers and objects,
Much less tests. You have much less testing in the end.
But that's again independent of this approach and this.
Right. So,
both.
Yeah, it can be used. So, if I believe I talked to Constantine like last year, because I thought this was like happening in parallel, and then he met me last year, and this is what I talked to in the morning, is that this can be considered as an like improvement to the ASAN.
I think so. principle before, because in my mind there are two things, you know, that we could reuse, at least two things that we reuse from this. First, the fast path.
Right.
First thing. And the second thing is the static analysis, you know, to be safe and stable. So for this first thing, all our red zones don't have the same value. That wouldn't have, because for stack, for the stack thing, you remember, okay, we were debugging too. At some point, we need to display stuff. So the bottom of the stack, the red zone contains, you know, information that
right.
is meaningful for debugging. So if you want to test,
but if we add some red zone about this,
okay,
yeah, another one.
So yeah, maybe yeah,
extra 8 bytes.
Yeah. Oh, okay, we have a lot of memory. So yeah. Who cares? So, yeah.
No, actually, that might have been the difference.
And for the implementation of your approach, well, the code could be shared like with the built-ins.
Or maybe we could know
with the built-ins. Doji spoke about. Yeah, basically, if we would emit these built-ins for both approaches early, then do the analysis, optimizations, vectorization with it, and then we can decide at run, yeah, at lowering time, okay, we are going to emit JSON stuff or your stuff.
Or JSON stuff, or FUSAN.
So, folks. I'm sorry, but I need to crash this party.